student, today we are learning a biodiversity and phytogeographical region of India. This picture is showing the variety of plant. Each plant having a different shape, size of leaves, and there are variety of colors of leaves. This is what a symbolic representation of biodiversity. You can see there are different plants we are looking in the picture, and that are the representative of biodiversity, that what we want to learn today under the concept of biodiversity and phytogeographic region of India. Scientifically, biodiversity is nothing but a variety of species in a particular ecosystem or in the particular geographical area. This variety of different types of system or species we can broadly say as a biodiversity. Or in other language, we also say that the living organisms of different types of ecosystems are of different size, shapes, structures, different numbers of chromosomes, more or less lifespan, interrelated to each other. They are also collectively called as a biodiversity. This term biodiversity was first developed by Walter Rogen in 1986. For representing the biodiversity, India has taken effort, and on the occasion of International Year of Biodiversity in 2010, India published a one postal stamp of different values. That postal stamp highlighting the picture of different animals and different kinds of biodiversity of India. If on the basis of classification, if we will see, there are different kinds of plants are there in the system of classification. When we going to learn a biodiversity related to plant, that kind of biodiversity we can say as a phytodiversity or plant biodiversity. Since the origin of plants, we can see how the different types of plants are originated on the surface of earth. First of all, when earth was formed, the first form of plant was reported, that is a unicellular alga. Later, this unicellular alga make a environment to develop a other plants, and the bryophytes are evolved or originated on the earth. After bryophytes, the pteridophytes are originated on the earth. After pteridophytes, the plant group called as a gymnosperms are originated on the earth. And today we are looking everywhere surround to us, there are flowering plants belongs to the group of angiosperms. That is what a recent dominant group of plant on the surface of earth. When we considered biodiversity of plants, there are spore bearing plants and seed bearing plants. The spore bearing plants may also called as a thallophytes. This includes the algae, mosses and ferns. Whereas the seed bearing plants are the flowering plants and they may be called as a angiosperm or gymnosperms. The angiosperms further on the basis of number of cotyledons in their seeds, we can categorize them as a monocot or dicot. This is what a basic picture of classification of the plant biodiversity. The classification of animals with respect to biodiversity is also on the basis of whether the animal is vertebrate or invertebrate. Vertebrates means the animal having a skeleton in their body, whereas invertebrates means the animal is without skeleton. For example, vertebrates are fishes, amphibians, reptiles, birds and mammals, whereas invertebrates are annelids, mollusks, arthropods, archids, echinoderms, and protozoa. This is what the classification of the biodiversity of the animals. There are three types of biodiversity. Scientifically, we can classify them: the genetic biodiversity, species biodiversity, and ecosystem biodiversity. The genetic biodiversity is on the basis of variation of the genome structure. Each and every organism has a different genes, or say different set of genes called as a genome. And these genetic variations reflects among the organisms. That is what treated as a genetic biodiversity. In Marathi, we also called it as a janukiya vividhata. Whereas the species diversity is referred as a variety of living species richness or number of species, different species in a definite area. And the ecosystem diversity means the broad difference of ecosystem types, including diversity, habitats, ecological processes occurring within each ecosystem type. The biogeographical classification of India was also more or less considered as a biodiversity of the Indian flora. On the basis of geographical parameters and climatic factors, the biogeographical classification of our country is made. And according to this biogeographical classification, our country is divided into the 10 biogeographic regions. Towards the north, there is a Trans-Himalaya. Next to these, towards the west, there is a Western Himalaya, next to Trans-Himalaya. Below the Western Himalaya, there is a deserts and semi-deserts Indus Plain. Whereas, towards the east, northeast, there is a Assam. Next to Assam, there is a Gangetic Plain. Next to Gangetic Plain, there is a Deccan Plateau. Towards the west, along the coastal side, there is a Western Ghat. Along the east coastal side, there is an Eastern Ghat. Whereas, both towards east and west, the coastal regions are there. And in the seas, there is some land covered all side with water, and that can be considered as islands. When, if you will see how these 10 biogeographic regions are made. These regions are made by considering the different factors: the amount of rainfall occurs, the quality of soil, geographical parameters like climatic factors, what kinds of climatic factors are present there. The Trans-Himalaya is northwest, towards the northwest of Himalaya. This is a very high altitude region. And in this region, there is a scattered kind of vegetation is there. Animals we can see like a white panthers, wolf, and most of the region is covered with a snow. The second biogeographic region, that is Himalayan region, towards north of India, evergreen coniferous forest is available in the Himalayan region. Animals like red panda, deer, wild dogs are occurs there. This Himalayan region is also of a high altitude region, and on the basis of altitude or height, there are three zones of these regions are made. That are the low altitude zone, then moderate altitude zone, and high altitude zone. Whereas, if you will come down from the north of India, there is a desert. Towards west of Arauli Mountain, the state like Rajasthan, Gujarat is a desert part. And in this desert, the plants, the amount of rainfall occurs is very less. The plants like grasses, cactus, thorny plants like animals, wild ash, deers, musk deers and wild cats we can observe. Some area is also treated as a semi-desert, that is somewhat the less intense caricity of the water. It is somewhat better than the desert area. Here you will find the dense trees, grasses, snakes, camels, donkey, jackals like animals, and the amount of rainfall is also somewhat more as compared to desert region. And this you can find towards the northwest of Arauli mountain. At the middle of the India, there is a Gangetic plain. Not exactly in the middle, but at the end of northern India, towards the south, there are Gangetic plains. This is what a very fertile part of land. From Arauli mountain to West Bengal, you can observe this part. And mostly the river Ganga is flowing in this region, and that's why this particular region is called as a Gangetic plain. Most of the area is under the cultivation of the irrigated crops like wheat, sugarcane and rice crops are taken in this region. Exactly in the middle of our country, there is a Deccan Plateau. This is what land between the Satpura and Sahyadri mountain, and this is what treated as a Deccan Plateau. Here you can see the dry deciduous kind of forest or mixed deciduous kind of forest, and the animals like tigers, deers, monkeys, owl, jackals you can find in this particular region. Western Ghats, this is what a one of the important part biogeographic region of our country, and this Western Ghat is start from the Gujarat and ends to the south at Kanyakumari. The variety of plants are observed in the Western Ghat. There are four or five types of forests are also reported in the Western Ghat, like evergreen forest, semi-evergreen forest, deciduous forest, thorny forest and grassland. Here the different types of evergreen and deciduous trees you can find. For example, the trees like palms, catechu, rubber trees, then mamecillon, mango. These are the some of the evergreen types of trees are reported in this particular region. Towards the east of our country, alongside of the coastal region, there is a Eastern Ghat. This Eastern Ghat is northeast region of India. And here also there is a good kind of plant biodiversity you can see. The very rare group of plants like orchids, ferns, wild bananas, bamboos, you can report in the Eastern Ghat. And on the basis of biodiversity, this Eastern Ghat is also includes the good amount of biodiversity. The coastal region. This region is around the coast or sea, around the sea coast, and biodiversity of the sea coast vegetation is a very typical. This kind of vegetation, the vegetation which is occurring in the sea coast called as a mangroves type of forest, and mostly in this region the mangrove plants are grows, and ecologically these plants or this type of vegetation is very important for the ecosystem as well as maintaining the coastal biodiversity of the sea region. The last biogeographic region of our country is islands. We have the four or five islands along the south of our countries like Lakshadweep, Bengal region, evergreen forest, mangrove forest, Andaman and Nicobar Island. In this region, the land is alongside covered by the sea water, and that is what at some places there are virgin kind of forest you can see here. The very rare groups of plants you can meet in the islands. On the basis of biodiversity of the world, There are more than 12 biodiversity centers are reported in the world, and in these more than 12 biodiversity centers, I think there are about more than 18 biodiversity centers in the world, and our country occupies, our country is one of them in the that 12 that 18 biodiversity centers. If you will see the biodiversity of India, there are about more than lakhs of flowering plants species which are identified. Animal species are more than 8,000. Mammals are about more than 350, whereas birds are about more than 1200. There are about 30,000 to 50,000 rice varieties in India, and many cow species, sheep species, goat species, and buffaloes are reported in our, which are identified for the soil conservation. Forest diversity also increases the nature of beauty. Soil microflora can also be enriched. Variety of animals, excreta can be useful as a biocompost. We can have the variety of microflora to increase the porosity of our soil. We also utilize biodiversity for producing the new varieties, also important for biotechnology, and also the microbes of different kinds can be useful for fixing the nitrogen and phosphorus to produce good quality of compost. Some of the areas of India are recognized as a hotspots of biodiversity: Eastern Ghat, Western Ghat, and Andaman and Nicobar region. These are the small regions, but they are very rich in number of species as considered to the biodiversity, and that's why they are considered as a hotspots of biodiversity. Nowadays, day by day, the biodiversity is going to be depleted. There are several threats to biodiversity. Some are natural and some are man-made. The natural threats are like a flood, storms, drought, scarcity of rain. Whereas the artificial threats are interference of human being, like commercialization of forest, grassland, improper development of project, artificial forest fires, cuttings of trees, then number of water bodies development, hunting animals, etc., industrialization, urbanization, mining, air pollution, water pollution, physiochemical changes in the water bodies. These are what the some human interference created threats to the biodiversity. Uses of vast amount of chemical pesticides and fertilizers, global warming, monoculture in farming. These are also the threats of biodiversity. There are some rare and endangered animal species are reported in India, like Asian lions, tigers, Himalayan panther, wild buffalo, black rabbit, Indian rhinoceros, dolphin, red panda, bear, tortoise, Nile monkeys, crocodiles. Conservation of biodiversity. How we can conserve the biodiversity? There are two ways of conserving the biodiversity scientifically: in situ conservation and ex situ conservation of biodiversity. In the in situ conservation, we can conserve the biodiversity at their natural site or natural place. For example, we can declare the reserve forest, we can declare the wildlife sanctuaries, we can develop the national park, we can declare the biosphere reserves. These are the kinds of in situ conservation of biodiversity. The second type of biodiversity conservation, that is a ex situ conservation. In the ex situ conservation of biodiversity, we can conserve the biodiversity outside the natural place or away from the natural place by creating the artificial habitats. for example, development of botanical gardens or plant parks, zoos, biotechnological parks, tissue culture techniques. These are the some of the examples of conservation of biodiversity. You can see these slides that are indicating the variety of plants forms as a diversity forms. These are the different examples of rose variety. That is what nothing but an good example, nothing but a good example of biodiversity of the rose. These are the wild varieties of grain. We have the lot of wild varieties of grain of a single species. There are lot of biodiversity is there. These are the different varieties of grapes, which is what a example of biodiversity. Different types of domestic animals, they are diverse in nature, and we can use
them for breeding purpose.